So today I'd like to present you our recent findings about the ground states of dipole lattice of heavy water molecules in beetle crystal. And I'd like to start with motivation behind this study. And the motivation is to explore the phase diagram of matter which produced by dipole-dipole interaction. The dipole-dipole interaction is quite interesting. Here you can see the formula. And from this formula, we can see what this interaction is characterized by a long range. The dipole-dipole interaction is long range and anisotropic. And these two features leads to new peculiar ground states. And the most famous one in the classic world is the normal field instability in ferrofluid air interface, when in strong magnetic field we can observe appearing of triangle lattice of spikes on the surface. In the quantum world, recently the supersolid state was observed, which is stabilized by a dipole-dipole interaction. Also, utilizing the dipole-dipole interaction, we can build the quantum simulator of spin lattices and even a quantum computer. So the motivation behind the study is quite strong, but how can we realize such system, such lattices of interacting dipoles? The two main ways is to use the cold atoms and some crystalline interfaces that we can localize separate molecules. And here you can see the lattice of beryl crystal, which forms the triangle lattice of nanocages. In those nanocages, single water molecules might be localized. The localization can be of two types. The water, the first type, we call it water one. Then the single water molecules localized in nanocage can freely rotate. And the water two types, then water molecules is strongly coordinated by the ion in the bottleneck. So it's almost completely fixed and cannot rotate. In this way, when we have this beryl crystal with non-class polar molecules, effectively we have the triangle lattice of freely rotating and interacting dipoles. And recently, the two phenomena was observed in such system. The first one is a quantum paraelectricity of such an ensemble of light water molecules. And in Cardioid crystal, which is just have a slightly lower symmetry, we observe the phase transition to ordered phase with coexistence of ferroelectric and anti-ferroelectric ordering. And now we can ask ourselves a question, how we can tune this dipole lattice to other phases. And one of the approach which used for different quantum paraelectrics is isotope substitution. Here you can see a picture for strontium titanate, the substitution of oxygen to heavy isotope leads to transition from quantum paraelectric behavior to a real phase transition to ordered phase. So to do the isotope substitution, we grow the beryl crystal with heavy water inside. Here you can see the IR absorption spectra, where you can see the distinct peaks for water, heavy water one and heavy water two molecules. So we very well characterized this sample. And here you can see the example of IR maps, which is basically the IR spectra taken at different point, and we integrate the distinct peak for water one and get the map of distribution of water one. From this picture, you can see what water one is very homogeneously distributed across the sample. And we also can plot the map of water two distribution. And here you can see only traces of water two molecules. So we can conclude what in our sample, the water in our sample is all, is almost all water in our sample is of type 1, the freely rotating one. And in this sample, the dielectric properties, in contrast to the previously studied light water beryl, the in the temperature dependence of permittivity after following the Curie-Weiss, we observed a saturation of permittivity. Here we can see the qualitatively different behavior. The permittivity at high temperatures first follows the Curie-Weiss behavior, but after that, the permittivity goes downward at around the Curie temperature, around 2 Kelvin. And this is the typical signature of the phase transition. We also measured the field dependence, but our sample almost didn't show any dependence on the constant DC field applied to a sample. And this behavior is might be understood from the imaginary part of permittivity, from a spectra of imaginary part. Here you can see the spectra at different temperatures here, and in the log-log plot, you can see what after cooling down below the 2 Kelvin, the white absorption band start appearing at the low frequencies for 4 magnitude of frequency. To better understand what happened in our system, we also did the targets and microwave measurements at different temperatures, and combining all the data together, we can plot the extremely wide band spectra of permittivity. And here you can see what the at the temperatures above the phase transition, above 2 Kelvin, 4 Kelvin, for example, you can see what the main features here is two absorption peaks, which along with the specific heat data, which we also measured. There we observed the Schottky anomaly in the specific heat contribution from the water lattice. This Schottky anomaly shows tells us what in the system there is two distinct levels with a spacing between them around 15 Kelvin in temperature units. So along with these data, we can plot the next picture. Here you can here we present the level structure of the water molecule in sand beryl. We just took the simple quantum harmonic oscillator in 6 well potential, which gives us splitting to 6 levels. But after applying the rotational symmetry responding to crystal, we got the degeneracy of 4 levels, and that gives us 4 level structure. This is the basic the level structure of water molecule in the nanocage. We can plot it for different height of the potential for different well of external potential. But in real crystal, the symmetry is not exactly PRV-free. The symmetry might be slightly breaking, might be slightly broken, and the degeneracy might be lifted. So we got the small splitting of two degenerate level, and we have the two-level system between the ground state and first excited state. And this level structure fits well with our measured spectra. This frequency falls, the frequency, low frequency absorption line is less than a gigahertz range. It corresponds to a split level, and the terahertz line is the corresponds to the transition between two level. But that's the picture for one molecule, one quantum rotator. But the dipole interaction between our rotators gives us the splitting of a ground state into lots of levels due to inhomogeneity and range dependence of interaction. So they got the highly splitted ground state, and this splitting, we believe, gives us the wide absorption continuum at the low frequencies. So this is the picture what happened in our system. At low temperatures, we just dive into this splitted region and got some new phase. But what kind of phase it could be? There are quite a lot of theoretical works on the quantum many-body system with dipole interaction, but all of them only restricted to 2D, two dimensions. And in those papers, the predicted phases ranges from spin liquid to XY magnet and some ordered phases. But unfortunately, there is no solution for quantum many-body system in three dimensions. In the sense, you can only speculate about how ground state might look like. And the exact nature of the exact picture of the ground state is should be clarified in the future. I come to the conclusion. Water molecules in beryl is a very good realization of angle lattice of freely rotating dipoles. Each water rotator below 50 Kelvin behaves in essentially a quantum way. And below 2K, we observed the sign of transition governed by dipole interaction, but the exact type of ground state is not figured out yet. So, and it should be clarified in the future.
You know, when you speak about polar molecules, you mean permanent dipole in the sense of permanent in the absence of external fields, and then these permanent dipoles interact among each other via dipole-dipole interaction.
Then they're talking about the lattice of water molecules. Water molecules have the permanent dipole, which is quite big. It's 1.8 debye. And yes, what I was talking about, it was interaction of permanent dipoles of water molecules without any external fields.
Oh, appear the presentation of Sophie Israel.
So let me make the presentation if I was happy to share the screen. Thank
okay.
you very much. Oleg, excuse me, please.
Yes.
So
yes. Oleg?
Recently, the attention of researchers has been attracted by multifunctional molecular materials which demonstrate two or several properties useful from the point of view of future applications within one and the same molecular unit. An appreciable progress has been achieved in this field, and the application of new experimental strategy by the group of Professor Sata, which allowed to design the chrome cobalt molecules exhibiting polarization switching that originates from valence tautomerism in cobalt ions. In this compound, the electron transfer from the BHSQ3- ligand to the cobalt ion has been detected by the absorption spectral transformation and by the magnetic properties. It's seen at the low temperature phase, we have cobalt 3 plus, and at the high temperature, cobalt 2 plus, the electron bond transfer from the ligand to the cobalt ion. It should be underlined that the such change in spectroscopic and magnetic characteristics are not observed in typical ferroelectric and electronic ferroelectric compounds exhibiting ion displacements. The crystallographic data show that the valence states of the metal ions are chrome 3 plus and cobalt at 200 K, while at 400 K, these valence states are chrome 3 plus and cobalt 2 plus, confirming thus the ligand metal electron transfer, which is characteristic of valence tautomerism. So the aims of the presentations are to develop a comprehensive model of the magnetic behavior of the crystal comprising the cobalt complex as a structural unit and demonstrating the valence to chimeric transformation accompanied by polarization change. To combine the modeling of observed properties with the initial calculations of several intrinsic system parameters to give a qualitative and quantitative interpretation of the observed changes in the magnetic polarization characteristic of the chrome cobalt system. So, from the experiment of Delta, that it follows that the valent tautomeric transformation is accompanied by charge density redistribution and polarization change. And three configurations of the cobalt ion and the ligands participate in this transformation. In the first configuration, the ligand bears an electron, the cobalt ion is in the low spin state 3 and 8 electrons. In the second configuration, the cobalt ion is in the low spin cobalt state 1 and 8 electrons. The ligand is diamagnetic. In the third configuration, the cobalt ion is high spin, 3 and 8 electrons. The ligand is diamagnetic, and chrome, as always, contains 3 and 8 electrons. In the first configuration, the spin takes on the value 1 and 2. In the second configuration, the spin takes again the spin values 1 and 2. And in the third configuration, the spin changes from 0 to 3. The total Hamiltonian of the crystal contains the Hamiltonian of non-interacting clusters, the dipole-dipole interaction, and the cooperative electron deformational interaction. The Hamiltonian of the electronic Hamiltonian contains, of course, the crystal field splittings, the energy gap between the configuration, the exchange interaction in the PS chrome ligand with the electron and chrome 3 plus cobalt 2. The electron vibrational interaction inside each cluster and the Hamiltonian of three molecular vibrations. The matrix element of the electronic Hamiltonian between states of configuration 2 and 1 is proportional to the transfer parameter. This transfer parameter in its stem is proportional to the overlap of the ligand, of the orbital of the ligand and of the cobalt 2 ion. The distance between the cobalt ion and the ligand is 3-point extreme. The mean value of the cobalt radius is 0.9 angstrom. So the overlap is small, and the overlap is small as compared, the transfer is small as compared with the energy gap with the configurations 1 and 2. So the configuration 2 is confirmed also by the experimental data lies much higher. So in the next consideration, we only consider the configurations 1 and configuration 3. We also noticed that the electron transfer, this is the matrix element of the electronic Hamiltonian, contains vanishing integrals proportional to the product of the orbital integrals and parametric symbols. Now we introduce the exchange coupling in the PS chrome 3 plus dash SU3 minus between the chrome ion and the ligand, between the chrome ion and the cobalt ion. They are characterized by the parameter J1 and J2. We also introduce in the model the electron vibrational interaction for the cobalt ion. We don't introduce in the model the electron vibrational interaction for the ligand, because if this electron formation, electron vibrational interaction is strong, the ligand cannot be, the electron cannot be tiered off from the ligand and transferred to the cobalt ion. So only the interaction of the cobalt ion with vibrations. The two vibronic constants for this both configurations, which are expressed through one electron matrix elements. The Hamiltonian also contains the Hamiltonian of three molecular vibrations and Hamiltonian of a single molecule. These three interactions I mentioned, and the first one is the gap delta between the configurations 1 and 3 introduced in the model. The transition is accompanied by electronic density redistribution. It is seen between the ligand and the cobalt ion, there is an electron transfer. So in the crystal, there is an electronic density redistribution. And so the dipole-dipole interaction is also introduced in the model. It is responsible for this distribution. So the dipole moments in the states of the low configuration one, which contains the paramagnetic ligand, correspond to the spins one and two of this configuration. D1, D0, D3, D4 are the dipole moments in the highest configuration and correspond to the spins 1, 0, 1, 2, and 3. Then we introduce the electron deformation interaction. Why? When the cobalt ion passes from the low spin cobalt 3 state to the cobalt high spin cobalt 2 state, the distance between the cobalt ion and the ligands increases significantly. And therefore, the electron deformation interaction is also accounted in the model. Here, V3 and V2 are the coupling of the cobalt ions of the cobalt ion with the polysymmetric strain in the high spin cobalt and low spin cobalt states. C1 and C2 are the bulk elastic modeling. What does it mean? So C1 refers to the space which to the complex from the cobalt and six nearest ligands. C2 refers to the intermolecular space, which is in the systems with spins crossover or other spin transitions very soft, and it's necessary to introduce both bulk modules. Omega zero is the volume of the molecule, cobalt ion plus atoms of the first coordination. Omega is the unit cell volume for the cobalt ion. And here is the matrix tau, which contains the same matrices as the dipole moment. Then we solve the problem in the mean field approximation. The mean distortion tau and the mean dipole moment, the mean dipole play the role of the order of the other parameters. We have two molecular field parameters, L, big letter L. It characterizes the dipole-dipole interaction, and J characterizes the electron deformation interaction. For these parameters, from the equations shown on the slide, we obtain self-consistent equations, which are solved. Then we speak about the characteristic values of the macroscopic parameters of the model. In the upper part of the slide, the functions which are used in the calculations and the valence basis are described, the accuracy with which we calculate the energy. We start with the calculation of the exchange parameter G1. This is the exchange interaction between the chrome 3 plus ion and the paramagnetic ligand, which bears an electron. First, we calculate this parameter from single point energy. What means single point energy? Single point energy is the energy of the complex and the fixed nuclear configuration. We use the functional battery leap and obtain that the parameter of interaction J1 is antiferromagnetic and equal minus 221 wave numbers. So this is this distance between the spins S2 and S1, and of course S1 is the ground spin for antiferromagnetic exchange interaction, and S2 is the excited spin. Then we use the broken symmetry formalism, which is often used in DFT calculations, to obtain the values of the parameter J1. We use fast calculations, battery functional, TPSS hash, and TPSS functionals. The parameters obtained are shown here, minus 89 wave numbers, minus 289, minus 332, and minus 443 wave numbers. So the exchange parameters in the series of functionals is increased. However, we take for further calculation the parameter J1 equal to minus 289 wave numbers. Why? Because the battery fractional contains the higher percentage of exchange, and therefore it gives the more reliable results for this interaction. Then we pass to the calculation of the exchange parameter in the pyrchrome 3 plus high spin cobalt 2. The ligand is now diamagnetic. Again, we use the difference of single point energies and obtain the value of 289 wave numbers. So the exchange in this pair is ferromagnetic. We also calculate these parameters with different functionals. And so we obtain very high values for the battery leap of TPSS hash for the fast calculation, a very small value for the parameter. And again, qualitative consideration. The mean distance between the mean radio of the chrome ions is 0.64 extreme. The mean radio of the cobalt ion is 0.6 extreme as well. By the while the distance between chrome and cobalt ion is 7.6 extreme and is significantly higher than the mean radio. So these values cannot be satisfactory. The maximum splitting provided by this exchange range from 4,000 approximately to 12,000 wave numbers. If we take into account this exchange parameters, we will never explain the magnetic properties. Therefore, further on, this parameter is considered as ferromagnetic one. The exchange interaction is considered as ferromagnetic one, but this parameter will be varied and obtained from the maximum coincidence of the experimental and theoretical data. I can add only that such a situation happens with the DFT calculation because the angular momentum, the orbital angular momentum of the cobalt ion is not completely plunged. And in this case, the DFT calculation fails. Then we calculate the zero field splitting parameter in the pair for the cobalt ion. In this case, the chrome ion is replaced by the value, by the diamagnetic gallium ion with the field 3D shell, not to have a mistake in calculations. We obtain for the zero field splitting parameter several wave numbers. The maximum splitting provided by the zero field splitting Hamiltonian is 68 wave numbers and much smaller than the characteristic splitting of other interactions. Therefore, it is excluded from consideration. Then we pass to the calculation of the dipole moments of the chrome complex, which I spoke before, they are different for different spin states. We again use the DFT calculations. The direction of the dipole moment is shown here, and approximately the center of gravity coincides with the middle of the line connecting the chrome and the cobalt ions. Here, there are calculated the dipole moment for different spin values. The low for the spin value one of the lowest energy configuration, the dipole moment is directed from cobalt to chrome. The dipole moment is also directed from cobalt to chrome in the highest configurations for the spin 1, 2, and 3, while it has the opposite direction for the spin value 0. But the maximum splitting caused by dipole interaction is 656 wave numbers. So further on, we identify these values with the dipole moments initially introduced in the model D01, D2, D31, D30, D40, D1, and D2. So the problem of dipole moments is solved. Then we pass to calculation of the electron deformational interaction, of the parameter of the electron deformational, which appears due to the expansion of the electronic shell of cobalt. it depends on the parameters V2 and V2, and this is the interaction with the deformation. These parameters, the interaction with the deformation, can be expressed through the vibronic constant, which in VFN can be calculated using the cubic parameters before for the low spin cobalt 2 and the for high spin cobalt 2 ions. The experimental value we are taking for the paper of Hendrickson, and we obtain the numerical value of the parameter of electron deformation of the ring. Then we make sample calculations. We would like to see how different parameters of the model affect the behavior of the model. We change the gap delta. This is the increase of the gap delta. First, the dipole moment, the mean distortion, and the effective magnetic show a hysteresis loop. When the gap increases, the hysteresis loop disappears, and the transition becomes gradual. The same effect is seen when we change the dipole-dipole interaction, because the dipole-dipole interaction decreases the gap delta. And finally, we considered the real compound about ice peak in the very beginning. We calculate the dipole moment for this compound, the mean distortion, and the effective magnetic yellow circles is the experimental data, and the blue curve or violet curve is the theoretical curve, which describes very nice the experimental data. The violet, the pink curve is the theoretical curve calculated with the parameters, with several parameters in neglect of federative interactions. We see that in this case, it cannot be reproduced, this step in the temperature dependence of the effective magnetic moment and the abrupt increase at higher temperatures. So these are the conclusions, and we acknowledge the support of the National Agency for Research and Development of Moldova. The project number is indicated. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you. Thank you for interesting talk. Thank you. Excitonic state in gallium selenide layer crystals. It's a work of our group and group from Pridnestrovia State University. Okay, why? What is it with gallium selenide? Gallium selenide, it's a monocalcogenide layered semiconductor, and it consists of two layers between from gallium and selenide tetrapods connected by van der Waals forces. It make possible to, by exfoliation or different mechanical or liquid exfoliation, make a very thin layered structure. Gallium selenide has been used as semiconductor, photoconductor, second harmonic generation crystal, and as far infrared conversation material, because it after illumination of this crystal by femtosecond laser signal, it generates terahertz radiation. And gallium selenide can be used in a solar cell and also in battery technology, like one of the electrode. It's used in photo transistors, field emitted transistor, light emitted transistor, because it has very good mobility and high concentration of electrons. But we investigated the optical properties, like usual, optical properties of this material. Here you can see the crystals of gallium selenide. It's quite big and can be chipped from the cleavage phase, and we received the mirrored natural phase of gallium selenide. The crystal lattice looks like in the slide. Exists two types, more types, polytypes, but more common, it's a beta and epsilon polytypes. We have the epsilon polytypes in our case because we measured the Raman spectra and observed phonons can allow us to contribute it to the epsilon type of gallium selenide. We investigated the optical properties of this material. We measured the absorption spectra of a thin crystal. This thickness around 12 microns. And absorption spectra demonstrate the usual behavior. It's shift this temperature decreasing to the higher energies. But in near H region, we observed the features which can be attributed to the excitonic states. At photoluminescence spectra, we observed the features which corresponded to transversal polariton. And also we observed the excited state of this polariton, exciton polariton. And calculated Rydberg of this exciton, we received around 120 millielectron volts. This so high Rydberg constant of binding energy of exciton shows us that this exciton, it's more probably it's a Frankel exciton. And we can see it in at the room temperature. At the low temperature, we in the absorption spectra see very sharp line, which correspond to the another exciton. It's a Vanier mode exciton, because this exciton has a very low binding energy. It's around 20 millielectron volts. And in the case of excitation, our sample, fixed sample, by different lasers, we excite by helium cadmium laser and semiconductor laser. And we see very sharp line corresponding to Vanier mode exciton, and a broad line corresponding to Frankel exciton. And some features which can be corresponding to a B exciton. The interesting thing that depending of the excitation energy, we can see and could not see the Frankel exciton. It's happens because of difference penetration of laser light into the crystal. Polarization reflection spectra of measured at low temperature show us the almost the regular excitonic reflection spectra. We see the ground state and excited state. We calculated the by dispersion equation this reflection spectra and estimate or received the parameters of exciton. Background dielectric constant, energy of transversal exciton, longitudinal transversal splitting, damping constant, and effective mass of exciton. Also, we measured the temperature dependence of these peaks of corresponding to the Van Jemot and Frankel exciton, and observed that Van Jemot exciton shift with temperature to the higher energies, but Frankel exciton shifts to this temperature decreasing to the lower end energies. We believe it that Van Jemot exciton appears due to the interaction between electron in conduction band C1, this hole from conduction band V1. But Frankel exciton appears due to the interaction between electron from conduction band C1 and hole through from conduction band V2. And this band has splitting due to crystal field. One splitting at the high energies, another one splitting at the lower energies. Also, at low temperature, we see simultaneously in reflection spectra the features corresponding to Frankel exciton, and these features looks like a spike corresponding to Van Jemot exciton. And also the luminescence spectra is dependent from the site of crystal where we illuminated by laser light. If we excited our sample to this mirror surface, which we received by exfoliation or something like this, or chipped our crystal, we received with spectra were dominated the excitation of Van Jemot exciton. If we excited our sample by the front side of sample, we received the spectra were dominated the Frankel exciton. Also, we calculated the parameters of this Frankel exciton. It's Rydberg, it's 120 millielectron volts, and calculate the effective mass of electron and holes in different valent bands and parameters of exciton. Okay. We observed in this material simultaneously two types of excitons, Frankel and Van Jemot exciton. And we calculated the parameters of these excitons and effective mass of electrons and holes in gamma point of in the center of Brillouin zone. It's all. Thank you. Thank you for help here. Thank you for your attention.
The title of our presentation is Electron Transfer Phenomenon in the Denuclear Iron Cobalt Complex, Interaction of Molecular Modes with Phonons. The research was performed in the Institute of Applied Physics, Chisinau, Moldova. At the beginning of the presentation, I will shortly explain why the studied systems are in focus of many research papers. Then the theoretical model for the analysis of this type of system will be presented. After that, the analysis of the experimental data will be performed, and at the end, a short summary will be given. Why? Systems with optical and/or magnetic instabilities are promising for application as components of memory devices, displays, and sensors. Among these systems, there are iron, cobalt, Prussian blue analogs. These compounds consist of iron cobalt units and manifest metal-to-metal charge transfer transition in the visible range, and this transition is accompanied by a transformation of diamagnetic low-spin iron 2, low-spin cobalt 3 dimers into the paramagnetic low-spin iron 3, high-spin cobalt 2 units. To create complexes with the better properties useful for practical application, one needs to understand which process govern the charge transfer induced spin transition in these compounds. And for this purpose, complexes with lower nuclearity, preferably dimeric complexes, are required. The first dinuclear cyanide bridge complex was reported in 2014 in the Journal of American Chemical Society. The structure of this complex is presented here. Both cobalt and iron ions are in octahedral surrounding. Cobalt is surrounded by six nitrogen atoms, while iron is surrounded by three nitrogen and three carbon atoms. This complex demonstrates charge transfer-induced spin transition under the action of temperature or light. And in this report, we will present the theoretical approach for the description of the behavior of this complex during charge transfer-induced spin transition, and will elucidate the main electronic mechanism governing this phenomenon. In our study, two configurations of the iron-cobalt pairs are taken into account, and namely configuration 1, low spin iron 2, low spin cobalt 3, and configuration 2, low spin iron 3, high spin cobalt 2. Choose of this configuration is based on the experimental study. Diamagnetic low spin cobalt 3, low spin iron 2 configuration gives rise to only one non-degenerate state. As for the energies of the levels arising from the high spin cobalt 2, low spin iron 3 configuration, as I already told, both metal ions are in cubic octahedral surroundings, and the energy of these metal ions are determined by the spin orbital and exchange interactions. It is well known that exchange interaction via the cyanide bridge is really weak, and for the spin transition at about 165 K, this interaction can be neglected. Under the assumption that the nearest ligand surrounding is pure octahedral, ground states of both high spin cobalt 2 and low spin iron 3 ions are orbitally degenerate. For both complexes, ground states are orbital triplets. For high spin cobalt 2, it's orbital triplet 41, and for low spin iron 3, it's orbital triplet 2T2. Spin orbital interaction splits both levels, and analysis of energy gaps demonstrate that for up to room temperatures, population of the excited quadruplet for iron 3 and excited sextet for cobalt 2 can be neglected. That's why in the our analysis, we take into account only these configurations. For excited configuration 2, high spin cobalt 2, low spin iron 3, we regard only two levels. One is a direct product of ground Cramer's doublets of iron and cobalt, and the corresponding degeneracy is 4. And second one is a direct product of the ground Cramer's doublet of low spin iron 3 and excited quadruplet of high spin cobalt 2. The corresponding degeneracy is 8. The analysis of structural data demonstrates that with temperature rise, iron ligands distances are almost constant in the whole temperature range. while the distances between cobalt ions and its first coordination sphere significantly increase with temperature. Thus, the deformation of the intercluster space during the transition predominantly occurs on the account of the cobalt ions. In fact, the iron ions do not contribute to any deformation of the space between iron cobalt units, which transmit the cooperative interaction between clusters. The cooperativity in this compound is mainly assured by the transformation low spin cobalt 3 to high spin cobalt 2. We suppose that the ligands of the cobalt ions participate both in molecular and crystalline vibration, and the resulting vibration can be written as a superposition of these two types, molecular vibration and contribution of phonons. For the first time, such a representation for a single impurity center in crystal was introduced by Professor Khizhnyakov, and for molecular crystals, we use this representation for the description of spin crossover phenomenon in iron compounds or in iron complexes of different nuclearities. The total Hamiltonian of the problem includes the Hamiltonian of non-interaction iron cobalt dimers, the cooperative interaction between dimers, the Hamiltonian of free phonons, and the Zeeman interaction. The cooperative interaction in this approach appears due to the assumption that the ligand surrounding of the metal ions participates both in the local vibration and in the vibration propagating along the crystals, i.e. phonons. Values of T, which presents in this equation, represent a product of molecular vibration coordinate X and electronic matrices tau. Tau low spin has both matrices tau are diagonal, and matrix tau low spin has a non-vanishing matrix element equal to 1 in the states of configuration 1, while the matrix tau high spin has a non-vanishing matrix element in configuration in the state of configuration 2. The problem of interaction ion is solved in the mean field approximation, and the role of all the parameters is played by the mean values of product of electronic matrices and coordinate of local modes. The energy levels, energies and partition functions, which are part of this equation, are presented in this slide. Under the assumption that long wave acoustic phonons produce a major contribution to the parameters of cooperative interaction, the parameters of this interaction can be written as is presented in this slide, where one omega with the corresponding subscript are the frequencies of molecular vibration of cobalt ions in the high spin and low spin states. Omega m is a maximal phonon frequency in the studied crystals. R are the cobalt nitrogen distances for low spin cobalt 3 and high spin cobalt 2 states. T is the speed of sound, and beta is a parameter of the model that describes the contribution of phonons to the local vibrations. A schematic image of cooperative interaction, which are involved in the process of charge transfer, induced spin transition, and the corresponding energy levels of the system are presented in this figure. This slide summarizes parameters which are used in our calculation. At first glance, a lot of different parameters, however, many of them are taken from literature or calculated with the typical values of other parameters which are typical for these complexes. For example, mean values of the parameters of cubic crystal field for cobalt ions are known for, well known from literature. Energies of molecular vibration for different types of metal ions also were taken from literature, where they have been calculated with the use of density functional theory. Cobalt ligand distances are taken from the structural data. The bronic coupling parameters for cobalt ion were estimated as derivatives of the cubic crystal field potential. As for the parameters of cooperative interaction, unfortunately, they cannot be calculated exactly since they contain unknown parameter beta that describes the contribution of phonons. However, we can calculate the ratio between these parameters, and instead of three independent parameters, we have only one parameter, which is used in the subsequent calculation. Really, we have only two parameters. First one is a parameter of cooperative interaction, and second one is an energy gap between the states of configuration 1 and 2. And this slide illustrates the effect of both parameters on the magnetic behavior of the studied complex. As can be seen from the left figure, increase of coupling parameter shifts the transition to low temperatures, and transition becomes more abrupt, and at some value of parameter, of course, at fixed value of the energy gap, hysteresis loop appears. Contrary, the increase of the energy between configurations 1 and 2 shifts the transition temperature to the higher temperature region, and the corresponding transition becomes smoother. And finally, we analyze the magnetic behavior of the real compound with the use of the presented model. Analysis of the magnetic data demonstrates that even at very low temperature, the Kt product of the complex is different from zero. Since configuration 1 is diamagnetic, it indicates that even at very low temperature, there are some fraction of high spin of configuration 2, which not participate in the spin transition and is in this dimers ion configuration 2 at any temperature. And we denote the fraction of this dimers as Y high spin. So the whole magnetic behavior can be calculated as a sum of two fractions, fraction which participates in charge transfer induced spin transition and fraction which is in the high spin configuration at any temperatures. The agreement between calculation and experiment is presented in this figure. As can be seen, model really good describes the behavior at low temperatures and the magnetic behavior at spin transition. It means the position of the hysteresis loop and the width of this loop. As for the coexistence between theoretical and calculated behavior at high temperatures, there is some disagreement, and this disagreement can be explained by the fact that in our calculation we assumed that surrounding of both ions is pure cubic. At the same time, crystal data indicates that there is some distortion from the cubic environment, and account of this real distortion may improve the agreement between theory and experiment. Briefly summarizing, in this presentation, we present theoretical approach for the description of charge transfer induced spin transition in denuclear iron cobalt complexes. We elucidate the main mechanism that govern this charge transfer induced spin transition. The experimental data of a real compound were analyzed, and the account of the real symmetry of the nearest ligands may improve the agreement with the experiment. At the end, we would like to thank the National Agency of the Research and Development of Moldova for financial support. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you.
Quickly. So the title of our presentation is Spin Crossover in Trinuclear and Protonated Tetranuclear Iron 2 Complex in DFT Modeling. So the phenomenon of spin crossover was discovered more than 19 years ago. It was a work of Cambi. This phenomenon attracts attention to a very promising application in smart pigments, optical switches, memory devices, molecular electronics, and spintronics and displays. The most interesting effect is demonstrated by the ferrum 2 ion. In the octahedral field, the five orbitals of the d-electronic shell is split, and at low temperatures, the electrons are paired, and the spin of the metal ion is equal to zero. And under the action of the temperature pressure of the light, the ion switches to the high spin state with the spin equal to two. The interesting thing is that the scientists looking for the complexes with the more interesting, more strong effects of the spin crossover, thus they increase the number of the ferrum ions of the metal ions participating in the spin crossover, and this allows to obtain two interesting things. It allows to increase the temperature of the spin transition and to increase the difference between the magnetic susceptibility values at low and high temperatures. One of the representative of this compounds is a trinuclear compound. It was published a paper in 2017. You can see the structure of this interesting and beautiful compound. It also looks very nice in the direction of connecting these ferrum ions. And at the low temperatures, the spin value of the complex is equal to zero, and the magnetic susceptibility is also equal to zero. With the increase of the temperature, the spin transition takes place at around 380 for 20K, and then the complex acquires a maximum spin value equal to 6, and the magnetic susceptibility is equal to almost 9, that describes very good the spin transition. To describe this spin transition, the authors also decided to measure precisely the structure of the complex at different temperatures, and they investigated the average bond lengths for the central metal ion and for the terminal metal ions, and they showed that this the change of the bond length corresponds very well to the change of the magnetic properties. This complex is the first one in which all three ferrum ions undergo a spin transition all together. Before, in previous complexes, only the central ferrum ion was participating in the spin transition. And this why this complex is very interesting. And the authors also were interested in to determine which one, which of the ferrum ions is the leading during this spin transition, the central or the two terminal ferrum ions. And the other complex is a tetranuclear complex. It was another complex which contains already four ferrum ions. The change of the properties in this complex is accompanied not by the light, temperature, or by pressure. The authors decided to modulate the magnetic properties by the chemical way, and it was possible by a good choice of the hydrazine-based dystopic isomeric ligand, actually four ligands, and using these four ligands, they managed to assemble this beautiful cluster, and with the increase of the base, this system loses the protons attached to the ligand. And this is manifested in the change of the optical and magnetic properties of the system. Now, the aims of our work is to explain the peculiarities of the spin crossover transformation in the ternuclear complexes with the aid of the single point drift calculation to determine either the central or the external metal ions are playing the leading part in the process of the spin transformation in the trinuclear system, to explain the peculiarities of the spin crossover transformation in the tetranuclear complexes, and to determine the effect of the protonation of complexes. Tetranuclear complexes on the course of the spin crossover transformation. The first, we proceed to the trinuclear complexes. The authors of this paper managed to give us, or just to the audience, a very good set of the crystallographic data that we used. They also, so we had a set of 15 crystallographic structures measured for different temperatures. And this allowed us to obtain very beautiful picture of single point energies for the different temperatures. At low temperatures, we can see that the ground state of the complex is takes the spin value equal to zero. And the other states with spin 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6 have the higher values. In the region of the spin transition, the energies are very close. And above the temperature of the spin transition, the ground state of the complex is already the one with the spin equal to 6, and followed with the states with the spin 4, 5, 2, 3, and 0, and 1, respectively. Here in this table, we presented the numerical values of the calculated energies. And here, just I decided to add the picture of the change of the average bond length for the ferrum ions, just to show that the change of the distances is also corresponds very well to the picture that we managed to obtain during our single point DFT calculations. I will show the middle middle section of this DFT single point calculation, and we will try to understand which are the ions participating, which are the ions actually represent the driving force in this spin crossover transformation. If we look at the bond lengths at 315 K, so we can see that the ferrum two ions possess three bonds with a little bit higher values than the ferrum one ion. And already at 320 K, when the spin transition takes place, the ferrum two ion also possess a group of three bonds which are a little bit bigger than have a higher magnitude than the bonds of the ferrum one ion. So we can say, based on this calculation and looking at this picture, we can observe that at 320 K, the spin of the complex is equal to 4. And then it immediately changes to the value equal to 6. But looking at this energy and at the spin of this state, and looking at this value, we can assume that the leading driving force in this spin crossover transformation is belongs to the two terminal ferrum ions. The next is the temperature dependence of the single point energies corresponding to the spin values 0, 2, 4, 6, and 8. Here for the tetranuclear cluster, we also used the crystallographic data in our calculations. And we started to investigate the energies, single point energies of the protonated, fully protonated tetranuclear complex at low and high temperatures. When the complex is fully protonated and has eight protons, so at low temperatures, the ground speed state of the complex is equal to zero, so all the centers are magnetically silent. And at the high temperature, the spin of the complex is equal to 4, which shows that the two ferrum ions undergo spin crossover transformation. Looking at this table, we can see that this is probably the ferrum 1 and the ferrum 4 ions, which have with average bond length equal to 2.15. The same calculation was performed for the complex with the 6 protons. With the addition of base, the complex lost his its protons. Here I showed the positions without hydrogens, and the green circles showed the 6 remaining hydrogens. In this situation, the ground state of the complex at low temperatures was equal to 2, and at high temperatures it was equal to the spin of the complex was equal to 4. In this case, only one ferrum atom was undergoing participating in the spin transition transformation with the change of temperature. Thus, this picture shows that qualitatively shows that with the addition of base, the number of the ferrum ions participation in the transition is decreasing. So we can come into our conclusions. The course of the spin crossover transformation in the linear complex was investigated in detail in the range of temperatures from 200 50 to 360 K. In this narrow temperature range, around 300 K, each thermions in the cleaner passes from the low spin diamagnetic state with the spin value to 1 to the state with the spin equal to 6. At the high temperature, confirm a complete spin Kersover transformation. Perform single point energy calculation revealed that the spin Kersover transformation observed experimentally probably occurs more rapidly in the two external thermions. And the results of the performed single point DFT calculations showed that the protonated complex, fully protonated complex, only two thermions participate in the spin Kersover transformation. That is in line with the behaviors of magnetic susceptibility of this complex. And the protonation affects the local surrounding of the thermions. And in this case, only one thermion participates in the spin transition. And the performed single point calculations confirm that the protonation of the tetranuclear complex offers unique possibility to modulate the magnetic properties of the complex in a chemical way. Thank you for your attention.
So today I'll present the investigation about the population dynamics in a modulated optomechanical setup, which is made together with under the supervision of Mikhail Makovey at the Institute of Applied Physics. So I'll start by giving an introduction, then I'll describe the theoretical approach, and I'll finish by giving results and conclusions. So the spontaneous emission of an emitter occurs when it interacts with its environment. So if we want to control this, how this emission goes, we can either change the energetic level of the emitters, the way it interacts with the environment, or the environment itself. And here I give you some examples of different types of spontaneous emission control, where either the environment or the interaction or the emitter was modulated or modified in order to achieve this control. What we have chosen for our model was a case of initially excited to level quantum dot, yeah, which has his transition frequency modulated by, for example, by an off-resonant laser. And we've put this quantum dot into an optical cavity with a low quality factor. So in order to achieve a bad cavity limit and high damping rates. And we've also considered put this quantum dot on a nanomechanical resonator in order to build a optomechanical device. So why we do that? Because we know that for the case of when we take a single atom and place it in a with a modulated transition frequency and place it in a bad cavity with a cavity with a low quality factor, we achieve spontaneous emission control and it decays more slowly. It happens when you consider transition as a modulation signal as a pure sinusoidal signal. So one of the first question we ask here, we try to investigate here, is what happens when we consider different modulation signals, not only pure sinusoidal ones. And another question is what happens if we introduce optomechanical part to this spontaneous emission control scheme. So the analytical model and the quantum dynamics is given by the Hamiltonian and its master equation, where the Hamiltonian is built by the free term of the quantum dot, where we have inserted additional term responding describing the modulation of the quantum dot transition, the free term of the mechanical resonator, the optical cavity, the interaction of the quantum dot with the phonons of the mechanical resonator, as well as the interaction of the quantum dot with the optical cavity. Sorry. And the master equation is described by the coherent part and also the damping terms, where we've considered the thermal damping of the mechanical resonator, as well as the cavity damping. So in order to solve this equation and the system dynamics, the first step we do, we try to eliminate the photonic operators, so the operators of the optical cavity. In order to do that, first of all, we consider a modulation signal being periodical, so that we can decompose it in Fourier series. Then we change, we choose a specific change of representation so that we are able to define the expression of the photonic operators. So we found them. And then we insert this expression of the photonic operators back into the master equation in such a way we eliminate them. So once eliminated, the Heisenberg equation for a system operator takes this form. And takes this form. So this is the final form. What I'd like to highlight here is that some coefficients that appear when we eliminate the photonic operators should be adapted for numerical calculus. And here for the calculus we use, we are limited to only a few Fourier terms in the Fourier composition. So we cannot treat the signals with big differences in frequencies. And once we found the general form of the Heisenberg equation, we could estimated the various parameters of interest. Particularly here in this study, I'll present the investigation of the population of the quantum dot, where from its equation of motion, we already can see that it's not affected by the presence of phonons into the systems, because. And one of the first investigation is to validate if the control and the slowdown of the spontaneous emission occurs. Here we consider, we look at the population of the quantum dot for two cases. In red line, we consider a quantum dot with a modulated transition frequency by a pure sinusoidal signal. And then we compare it to the case when we have no modulation at all. And we see that here we have a clear enhancement of the lifetime of the excited population of the quantum dot. So it's kept more time in the excited state. And what we try to look further is to consider what happens if we, instead of taking a pure sinusoidal signal, like in red here, we will try to consider a similar modulation signal, but this time with some fluctuations in it. This is particularly interesting because these fluctuations can also originate from imperfection or impurities in the energetic bands of the quantum dot. So what we find here is that when we consider modulations with some fluctuations inside, we have a more increased slowdown of the spontaneous emission effect, so longer lifetime of the excited state population of the quantum dot. Different investigation occurred is we consider modulation signals which has a slowly varying amplitude, like in the case when the modulation which occurs by applying an off-resonant laser to the quantum dot this laser has a varied intensity, so we have a modulation signal with a varying amplitude. What we obtain here is very tricky, and it depends actually of which cavity we choose. Because in this particular case presented here, we see that the excited population of the quantum dot has a longer lifetime, but it happens only when the width of the optical cavity is of the same order of magnitude as the frequency of the of the amplitude of the signal. So if we consider other cases when the optical cavity is broader than the frequency of the amplitude. So when K is bigger than omega, in these cases, we will have the contrary effect. We will see shorter lifetimes of the excited population of the quantum dot than when comparing to a pure sinusoidal signal. And from the other part of the investigation, which is still in preparation, we look at what happens to the mechanical resonator and how the slowdown of the spontaneous emission, which occurs, does influence the quantum mechanics of the mechanical resonator. So here again, we try to compare two different cases. In blue lines here, so first of all, we look at the mean phonon number of the mechanical resonator and try to compare two different cases. In blue line here, we have a quantum dot with a modulated transition. And in red line, we have the case when the quantum dot doesn't have any modulation, transition modulation. So what we see here is that the enhanced lifetime of the quantum dot excited population leads to enhanced lifetime of the generated phonons inside the mechanical resonator. And this is explained by the fact that the phonons from the mechanical resonator couples only to the excited state of the quantum dot, only to the exciton which is created inside. So longer this exciton lives, more phonons we have and more lifetime, with a longer lifetime we have inside the resonator. So in conclusions, what we've investigated and found here is that for modulation signals possessing fluctuations, we have a clear enhancement of the slowdown effect of the spontaneous emission with the longer lifetime of the excited population. In the cases for signals with the slowly, for modulation signals with slowly varying amplitudes, we may either have longer or shorter lifetimes of the excited population depending on how this slowly varying amplitude scales to the width of the optical cavity. And in what concerns the phonon dynamics, we've found out that the presence of phonons into the system does not affect the dynamics of the spontaneous emission, but the change in the dynamics of the spontaneous emission does affect and is transferred to the dynamics of the phonons, which are also slowed down. So I'd like to thank you, everyone.
Okay, Victor, thank you for nice presentation. Are there some questions? Okay, if not, I have one question. Okay, you have amplitude A, and you listed the parameter A divided by omega. Once I observed it equal to 60, this means you have a small modulation. Another one, you increase to 200. 200, it's not too much. I mean, in this case, you will have the force something you to the system or not. You understand what I mean?
Yeah, I understand. So first of all, it's the omega of the modulation, not the omega of the quantum dot transition. And basically what I wanted to find here is that what I wanted to show here, to represent here, it's an exaggerated case of a spontaneous emission decay, which goes, which has a lifetime way bigger than the case of a non-modulated quantum dot. So basically the choice of A here affects only how much the quantum dot is kept in its excited state. And it could also work similarly for other A's, for any A.
Okay, thank you.
My name is Alexey Mishalkin, and I will speak about the photo-induced anisotropy in azopolymer studied films by spectroscopic and polarimetric parameters. It was done in the framework of a joint project RNET RAS Plus. And here is presented our member groups. First of all, I want to congratulate the Konstantin Lashmansky for the appearance of new member of family in his family, and to wish a good health for the child and a new success in his research activity. So here's the outline of my presentation. We will discuss about the photosensitivity media based on azobenzene-containing polymers. Next one is photo-induced motions in azobenzene-containing polymers. I will speak about the obtaining of azopolymers in films, and then the investigation of the properties of these thin films by polarimetric measurements and spectroscopic investigations. And the next will be conclusions. So first of all, the photosensitive media based on azobenzene-containing polymers are very attractive because it uses the cis-trans isomerization of these molecules. And among the different types of photosensitive media, these materials have received the most attention due to rapid and reversible nanoscale photoisomerization. It can be done by polarized light illumination in the ultraviolet and visible region of spectra. And usually the polymer is host materials. And using the light illumination, it can give rise to large scale motions in these films, such as macroscopic mass transport with polarized illumination. It has great potential in various areas, ranging from photonics to biology. The photoisomerization of azobenzenes is the origin of many interesting phenomena and used in different applications, such as molecular machines and holographic recording devices. Usually it involves the passive polymer and photoactive small molecules, such presented here. It's azobenzene. It's we name it azodice or azochromophores. And one of the common features of azobenzene molecules is their strong electronic absorption in the ultraviolet and visible wavelength region. So the motions, photo-induced motions in these materials can be divided into three categories. First of all, it is molecular motions presented here. During this motion, the molecules, azobenzene molecules, transforms from trans to cis and the next trans isomerization. And the chromophore concentration in the direction of polarization is changed. The next category of movement is domain motions. At this level, the polar chromophore movement reorients the polar domains, the all polar domains. And the third one is mass level motions. It's about microscopic motions. It produces a macroscopic movement of polymer that can be used for inscribe surface or bulk patterns in the thin films. So first category is molecular level motions. As you can see, it is triggered by the light, polarized light, usually in the ultraviolet region. And the next transformation in the transform is can be done by blue light or heat. During the illumination, the molecules having their transition dipole moments perpendicular to the light polarization direction. Since the transition dipole moment vectors of the trans azobenzenes typically coincides with the axis connected with the midpoints of the two benzenes. The molecules are perpendicular to the polarization plane of slides, and they are inert to the incident beam. On the other hand, the selectivity also originates from the fact that the absorption probability is proportional to the angle between the polarization direction and the chromoform dipole moment axis. So the next category is photoinduced alignment of azobenzene in the domain range. During this illumination, the bilinear polarization the molecules are arranged in the plane that is perpendicular to the polarization of the light, and it leads to the appearing of birefringence and dichroism in these polymer films. And the third one is the most interesting. It is macroscopic level motions of the polymer films. It leads to the Cefax patterning with a higher height. He has presented the IFM image of the polymer film that was illuminated by the polarized light. If we put our sample in the range of interference of two beams, it leads to the forming of periodic patterns on the film surface, on the macrometer size, and the mass migration on this film is strongly depends on the polarization of the interfering beams. So about the obtaining of our azopolymers in films, we used epoxy propyl carbazole as a polymer host, and we acquired the solvent yellow 3. It is azo dye that is commercial available from Sigma Aldrich. By using this stem of refluxing of polyepoxy propyl carbazole with azo dye, with different weight of azo dye, we obtained three different samples with different weight of our azo dye. It is 0.3 gram, 0.4 gram, and 0.5 gram weight. And with polyepoxy propyl carbazole with a mass of 1 gram, it was combined and dissoluted in the toluene, and it was reflux for 8 hours, and the resulting solution was cooled and filtered. Then this solution was spin coated on the glass substrate, and here is presented the scheme of obtaining of thin films during spin coating. It has three stages. First of all, the solution is put on the glass substrate. The second one is rotating of substrate with a rotation of 800 rotation per minute. During this rotation, the solvent is evaporated. And the next one, the thin film is formed, and then it is dried at room temperature for 20 to 24 hours. He has presented one of the obtained thin films. It is the transparent and the visible range. The next one, it was set up, it was constructed the setup for the polarimetric measurements. He has presented the two laser sources. First of all, it is linear laser polarization sources like as blue lasers. It is illuminated on our sample by the wave plate lambda lambda divided by two. We can rotate the linear polarization of the light beam on the sample. And he has presented the scheme polarization or polarization states of the illuminated light blue laser and the reading red laser. It is helium neon laser. So the angle of blue laser was changed from the 0 degree up to 180 degree, while the helium neon laser was a constant angle. It was 134 degree. And next we used polarimeter to the measure the light transmitted through the sample. We have measured the azimuth and ellipticity of light that was transmitted through the sample using Torlaps polarimeter. The next one, it was measured the transmittance spectra of our polymeric films. Using this spectroscopic investigation, it was calculated the refractive index. It is shown in the inside in the figures. It was measured for the three types of our polymer films with 0.3, 0.5, and 0.5 gram per solution. So we can see that after the illumination, we have changes in the transmission spectra. Using these changes and using this transmission, we obtained the refractive index before illumination and after illumination. Before illumination, it is the black line, and after illumination, it is red line. And we calculated the refractive index and the modulation of refractive index before and after illumination. And we have shown that this refractive index modulation, it's about zero for the 0.3 gram. It's about 0.01 for the 0.4 gram of azadai. And the largest refractive index modulation, it's observed for the azopolymer with 0.5 gram of azadais. So the shift in transmission spectra of these azopolymer films after radiation indicates the presence of the cis isomers of azadai, the solvent yellow 3, due to the photoisomerization process during the illumination. The next one was the polarimetric investigation independence of exposure angle and chromophore concentration. Here is presented three types of our samples. It is 0.3, 0.4, then 0.5 gram of azadai. It was determined the thickness of obtained films. It was it is shown here. And to study the photoinduced changes in azimuth ellipticity of these films, with these parameters, we measured the kinetics of the change in degree of polarization. And we have choose the exposure time like 6 minutes. It's about 360 seconds. Where the saturation take place. So we compared these three our samples, and the polarization plane of illuminated light was changes from 0 degree up to 180 degree with a step of 10 degree. And the exposure of material was done by the blue laser at 473 nanometers in 6 minutes for every exposure. So here is the presented results of temporal changes of azimuth angle for each angle of polarization from 0 degree up to 170 degree for each type of our polymer films. Every 6 minutes we changed the polarization angle. And from these curves, we can see the cyclical change of azimuthal angle, which directly indicates the reversibility of the process associated with the photoinduced changes in the position of the molecules in the volume of the azopolymer. At the same time, the relationship is observed between the maximum angle of the azimuth and the thickness of the polymer, of the azopolymer thin films. So it can be assumed that increasing the film thickness leads to a decrease in the azimuth angle of the radiant beam, laser beam that is transmitted through the sample during the illumination. The next time is the investigation of ellipticity of a red laser beam. It presented the same three types of our azopolymers with different azodi concentration. And like azimuth, the ellipticity is the same change cyclically over the time. And it can be assumed that the maximum value of ellipticity depends on the concentration of the chromophore in the azopolymer films. So the next time it's graphs of dependence of the azimuth and ellipticity, is azimuth and films ellipticity, on the rotation angle of the probe laser beam. During this experiment, the illumination light was constant, but the probing laser beam was rotated the same by, from the 0 degree up to 180 degree. And he has presented the azimuth dependence and ellipticity dependence of the red laser beam, from which it can be clearly distinguished that the azimuth average from the for the given samples is proportional for the film thickness, while the ellipticity depends on the concentration of the azodine. And it have a decrease value with the increasing of the concentration of azodine. So some conclusion, in summary, the photoinduced anisotropy of our azopolymer film based on polyepoxy propyl carbazole and solvent yellow 3 was investigated. For it, we used a blue laser at 473 nanometers. It was determined that refractive index of azopolymer in films depends on chromophore concentration. And during the illumination, the changes of refractive index is different for different azopolymer concentration and consists about zero for the 0.3 gram of azodine. And the refractive modulation is about 0.01 for the 0.4 gram of azopolymer dye. And the maximum value of refractive index modulation is about 0.03. And it corresponds for the other polymer with the other dye about 0.5 gram per solution. Also, the maximum azimuth change was achieved in the sample with the mass ratio of 0.3 gram per solution, while ellipticity reaching 49. It was shown that an increase in the azimuth angle increases with the increase in the thickness of the polymer films, while the increase in ellipticity occurs as the concentration of the chromophore in the polymer decreases. And for the sample with mass ratio of 0.3 gram, the maximum value of ellipticity reached 1.3 for the right azimuth and minus 1.62. For the left azimuth position. So I want to thank the project that was founded our research. It is RNet RAS Plus project, and thank you for your attention. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Alexei. So are there any questions, please? Okay, if not, may I have one? So if I may misunderstood something, but depending on the polarization of the lasers, do you have more lines in the interference patterns or less lines on the same size or not? Is there any dependency?
It's no dependence on the polarization state of the illuminated light. The interference pattern depends only on the thickness and the refractive index of our sample.
So no dependence on polarization?
No dependence on polarization.
But only the depths in the material depends on the polarization or not?
Yes, thickness of materials depends.
Okay, thank you. So
the majority of spin crossover systems systems with iron two fines. These transitions occur, this crossover is characterized by the transition between states A1A and 5Q2, the significant difference in spin and orbital degeneracy. In this case, the crossover shows different types of temperature dependence of the high spin fraction. The transition is more pronounced than in cobalt ions, and it is not accompanied by the change in the crystal symmetry with temperature. Therefore, the deformation arising from the low high spin transition is mainly a full symmetric one, without change of symmetry, crystal symmetry. The coupling with the iron ions with tetragonal or trigonal vibrations plays a secondary role and can be neglected. Next. So another situation happens in spin crossover cobalt compound. The low spin cobalt 2e state contains only one unpaired electron and six paired up electrons. The high spin cobalt ion contains three unpaired electrons and two pairs of paired up electrons. Here states are 2e and 4t1. The difference between the spins of participating states on cobalt ion is much smaller as compared with that for the high spin low states of the iron 2 ion. Coupling of the ground 2e state with the young Taylor tetragonal mole leads to additional stabilization of this state and makes the condition for observation of spin transition more rigid than for iron ions. The smaller change in the spin associated with the transition and operation of the young Taylor effect in the states involved in this spin conversion lead to special features of spin crossover in cobalt 2 compounds. Here is the picture of one of the cobalt compounds, which will be considered in our work. The aims are to develop a model that accounts for both the spin crossover phenomena and the young Taylor effect in cobalt II compounds, to explain on the basis of the model the observed behavior of the three compounds obtained by the group of Kim Dunbar. So the system demonstrated spin crossover belongs to the class of molecular crystals. The vibrations of a molecular crystal can be subdivided into types, the molecular one and the intermolecular type. The role of these vibrations in the spin transformation is different. While the molecular vibrations directly coupled to electron, to the electronic shells of spin crossover ions form the energy spectra of these ions, their intermolecular vibrations transmit the local strain appearing due to the spin transition throughout the crystal. In our earlier papers, it was suggested that we can replace these two types of vibrations by introduction of two types of strains. These strains are shown here, C1 and C2. C1 is the strain characterizing the more rigid space, which contains the cobalt ion and the ligands of the nearest surrounding. And C2 characterizes the elastic model of the intermolecular space, which is solved and gives the possibility to the spin crossover ion to expand during the transition. The Hamiltonian of the crystal contains the Hamiltonian of isolated cobalt ions, the cooperative electron deformational coupling, as well as the electron vibration interaction in the Hamiltonian 3 lattice vibrations. The latter terms are introduced in the total Hamiltonian, since the cobalt ions in the octahedral surrounding interact with 15 vibrations of the surrounding in both low spin and high spin states. At the same time, the electron vibrational coupling does not mix the ground low spin and the excited high spin state, and this is clear. The states possess different spin multiplicity. The Hamiltonian of isolated spin crossover ions includes the spin orbital interaction within the cubic 41 triplet of the high spin cobalt ion, the splitting of the ground T2E i temp of the low spin cobalt ion by the low symmetry crystal field, the Zeeman interaction. In the high spin configuration, you see this temp accounts for the unquenched orbital angular momentum of the cobalt ion. The Zeeman interaction in the low spin configuration here is the 2V state, it does not possess an orbital angular momentum. And in the energy gap between the high spin 41 temp and the ground 42 temp. The matrices are special for the high spin state and for the low spin state. Then we introduce the electron deformation interaction. In this case, we introduce two types of electron deformation interactions. For the high spin 41 state, we introduce the interaction with the A1 strand, full symmetric strand, which does not change the symmetry. And for the E state, we introduce the interaction with the A1 and the E stress. The values, the tensors of these interactions are shown here. The coupling with the E strain is strong for the low spin D7 configuration with a singular electron in the E orbital and gives large energy stabilization due to this strain. The effect of the E strain is less noticeable for the high spin state. X-ray data shows structural compression along the fourth order cubic axis, so we take the U component only in our consideration of the entire of deformation. Then we write the Hamiltonian of electron deformation interaction. First, it was written as a function of the stress, then minimized over the stress, and we obtain the two terms of inter-ion interaction. The first term describes the electron deformation of cooperative interaction arising from the full symmetric deformation, and the second term describes the E strain. Then the problem is solved in the mean field approximation to reduce the problem of interacting cobalt ions to one cobalt ions. Here are the mean values of the distortion produced by the full symmetric strain and by the tetragonal strain. The rho is the density operator. The partition function represents a product of the electronic statistical sum and vibrational sum. The vibrational sum is shown here. We take into account the 15 vibrational modes, and for them we use the frequencies obtained by DFT calculations. Then we estimate the interaction, the constant of interaction with the totally symmetric strain. The operator of the totally symmetric strain is shown here, and the constant it can be expressed through the parameter the Q, the cubic crystal field parameter in the high spin state. The same is for the low spin state. The parameter is shown here, and the value of the cubic crystal parameter used is also shown. We take into account that all three compounds have different volumes falling on one cobalt ion, and take also the elastic moduli from literature. The elastic moduli C1 and C2, C3, C1 and C4, C2 and C4, they enter in the expression for the cooperative electron deformation parameter. So we obtain the values for the electron deformation of parameters shown in the slide. Next, we should estimate the characteristic parameter which characterizes the coupling of the cobalt ion with the tetragonal strain. Here it's shown the parameter of the tetragonal, the constant of interaction with the tetragonal strain V2. It is expressed through the electronic matrix element of the vibration, tetragonal VU vibration. And this is the parameter of electron deformational interaction on the account of the tetragonal strain. So because we have the compression of the complex, therefore for estimation of the strain, we use the operator of interaction with the tetragonal strain. It contains two parts, the contribution of the point charge, and the contribution of the exchange charge. S4 and S4 are the overlap integrals in their derivatives. To calculate the matrix element of interaction, we use the following wave function and the parameter J characterizing the covalence effect. We calculate from the Dupont parameter, which is taken from experimental data. We obtain for these compounds the parameter J2, which characterizes the catalytic interaction with the tetragonal strain. And now here we show the results obtained. This sets of the best fit parameters for all three compounds reasonably describe the experimental curve from one compound to another. As the fitting parameters, we use the energy gap between the high spin and low spin state, the energy gap that determines the splitting of the EPM, and the initial concentration of cobalt ions, which are in the high spin state from the very beginning. The calculating fractions, mu high spin of ions, which are in the high spin from the very beginning, are in good agreement with the observed ones. The inequality between these values obtained with the aid of the best fit procedure is confirmed by the experimental data. The gaps obey the inequality, the gaps between the high spin and low spins obey the inequality shown in the set. That leads to the situation in which, starting from 200K, the highest is the high T curve for the compound one, and the lowest one is the heating curve for the compound two. And this is in line with experimental data. The obtained negative values of the parameter data correspond to the axial compression of the local octahedron, stabilization of the V component of the 2EW. The calculated parameters of electron deformation interaction are also in line with the experimental data. So the conclusions: to describe the observed temperature increase of the magnetic susceptibility and cobalt compounds, along with the interaction with the full symmetric deformation, accompanying the spin transition, the interaction with the tetragonal model for the low spin state, it was necessary to introduce in the developed model. The mentioned two interactions play a different role in the spin transformation in the cobalt compounds and compete with one another. The coupling with the full symmetric strain reduces the distance between the states participating in the transition and, in fact, facilitates the transition. The role of the tetragonal mode is different since it splits the ground low spin E level, increases the energy gap between the states participating in the transition, it leads in main to the gradual type transitions and cobalt compounds. And so we acknowledge the support of the National Agency for Research and Development of Moldova. Thank you for attention. Hello.
Okay, thank you, Professor Klokishner. Are there any questions, please? So, if not, I may try. Can you have some idea what would happen around sub-Kelvin temperature, for instance, when you start?
With very, very low temperatures. So, okay, we use the experimental data, which really show very low temperatures. I cannot say about the situation which happens in the other temperature interval. I can speak only about the situation which I know from the experimental data. At low temperatures, the system is in the low spin. Then, due to cooperative interaction, it passes to the high spin state. The transition is gradual because the cooperative electron deformation interaction is not so strong. If the cooperative electron deformation is stronger, we can observe another type of transition. Besides, in this system, the difference between the spin states is very low. And so we see a small degrees in the Calti product. The transitions, spin crossover transitions, are more pronounced for iron ions, where the spin of the low state is zero, and the spin of the excited state is two.
Okay, thanks, Sue.